you about the Sakala program. And I'm mentioning it particularly because I think it's a case of sound policy with effective implementation that has led to optimal outcomes. And I'd like you to look at it and challenge my assertion about it being sound policy and effective implementation. So this was the government led by Mr. Sadanand Gowda, who succeeded Yediyurappa. And Sadanand Gowda wanted really to bring about some changes in the way benefits are given to the public, especially, you know, ration card, old age benefits, etc., etc., driving license and so on. And he had a very good law minister called Suresh Kumar, who is also, by the way, minister for primary education now, and he called a few of us and said, you know, look at what other states are doing and see if there is something that we can do in terms of, you know, ensuring that the implementation of whatever goods and services from the government are concerned, that implementation takes place speedily without people having to go helter-skelter, running from place to place, and so benefit from it without also corruption. And ironically, we discovered that in Bihar, not particularly known for good governance, there was an act called the Right to Public Services Act, RTPS. And this Right to Public Services Act that they had in Bihar guaranteed the citizen that a particular, whatever service was there, like say a ration card or a license or khata, those would be delivered to him or her within a particular time. That was the guarantee. And the other aspect of the guarantee was that if a public official wantonly delays in the, you know, delivery of the service, that public official would be fined. Okay? So there was a penalty measure also. And so that act was actually started by Nitish Kumarji when he first term as Chief Minister. And we went to Bihar to study that act, and we met Mr. Nitish Kumar, a very charismatic person. And we went around some districts in Bihar to see if it is really a fact. And we discovered, Guru, that there is a very strong IT backbone to this. Because that IT backbone monitors when was the application given, okay, and within how many days was it delivered, and it is there's also a call center. So if you are a citizen in whatever district, Champaran, and if you have asked for a particular service and that has not been delivered at time, you can call that service center and say, you know, this is my number or whatever it is, and they are expected to get back to you and give you a feedback as to what is happening. And we were deeply impressed because if Bihar can do it, think what we can do in Karnataka. So we came back and we put together a policy note for the cabinet and said, like in other states, we too should have a right to public services. And so this is how we can go about it. And the cabinet, one of the ministers had an excellent idea. This is just to tell you that not all politicians are bereft of ideas. And he said, so why don't we give it a new name instead of calling it by that arcane Right to Public Services? Give it a nice name. And that name itself, we can have a competition among the public. And whoever suggests the right name, we can, you know, give a 1 lakh or whatever amount, etc., etc. So we had one of our colleagues do this competition for this service name. And that name Sakala came from Mysore, from a college school student, high school student, to whom we gave a lakh of rupees. And Sakala is absolutely apt, you see. In Kannada it says?
Timely.
Timely. Sakala. So we put together the Sakala program, and then we had a legislation. And that legislation was passed unanimously by the legislature, obviously, because nobody will dispute that this is a good progressive piece of legislation. So once we had that legislation in place, then the finance department also was kind enough to earmark resources. And the chief minister asked me to head the project when I was additional CS. And so I adopted a good management technique. I said, We will not roll it out in one go. We will have a series of pilots. So this is a standard thing you do in management, that you first test out the concept in practice and see what are the snags, and thereafter we can, you know, implement it. So we had pilots in four different areas of the state, east, west, north and south, and we then estimated what will be the staff requirement for this, what will be the IT requirement, how do we provide the IT requirement at the district level. Having made all those calculations, and I'm not going into them in detail, what we did was we put together a program under a mission director. We had a mission for Sakala, and we had a capable IAS officer as the head of the mission, and she had a deputy also, with another capable IAS officer. So under that mission mode, we corrected all the gaps that were there in the pilot project, and having corrected that, those gaps, having provided the resources, having ensured a good IT backbone at the district level, all the districts of the state, we rolled out this Sakala. After about 6 months of the legislation being enacted by the legislature, so that 6 months time we spent in terms of proofing this whole thing, and then we rolled it out, and soon thereafter I retired. At the point of my leaving the government, only about 50 services were included in Sakala. This was on the 80-20 rule, which says that, you know, 20% of all the services contribute to 80% of the demand from the public. The balance are there, but you know, they are not that important. And that was done, and Sakala was monitored, there was a scoreboard, etc. In front of Vidhan Sabha, there was a big scoreboard, how many services are given and how many requests, etc., etc. After that I left, and a couple of years later I asked one of them, so how is Sakala going on, how is it doing? And he said, Sakala is completely watered down. I said, why? He said, today 750 services are part of Sakala. 750, as against the 50 or 51 that we had. So these 751 services have to be monitored, and so on and so forth, which is a different story. And just the other day I read 1500 services are now part of Sakala. So the question was, you know, this 80-20 rule in which you target only those of priority and put it together, but now it has become a little, it has become a kind of catch-all situation where everything is put under Sakala. Of course, there is need to ensure that all of government services are delivered to the citizens on time without any exception. But the point was that some more strategic services that bear on their livelihood, that are very important for them, if those could be targeted and provided, then it would be useful. Now I'm mentioning Sakala because I think it's a case of sound policy with effective implementation leading to good outcomes. The policy was sound because it was very clear. The program, the design of the policy was clear, that you have to provide services on time, and these are important services. You have to remove touts and intermediaries from the interaction between the public and the government, and for doing so, there is a, you have to do it in a particular manner. You have to have a scheme by which you say, these are the amount of days that can be provided, this is the flow of paper, and so on and so forth. And more than that, you also make sure that there is accountability at the end of it by saying that that service provider will be accountable, and if he or she defaults, there's a certain fine to be paid. And the way you monitor the whole thing is through an IT system, and that IT system is available to the public, so that if I'm a member of the public, I can access it and find out where my service is, why is it being, when is it being delivered, is it being delayed, and if in my opinion there's intentional delay, I can go and file a petition with the concerned person and say that this this delay is wanted. And why we put so much of emphasis was because if in Bihar we came to the conclusion that corruption had declined, you know, in terms of somebody procuring the services and getting money from you, If Bihar corruption had declined, in Karnataka we could have made a sea change, because by all standards this is a better administered state with good administrative conventions and traditions. So that's why I say that Sakala, to my mind, is a case of sound policy with effective implementation, leading to policy good outcomes, except that it has been watered down unnecessarily because maybe the government of the day has some other ideas of what should be included or not included. Now, I want to end on one note. I spoke about sound policy, sound implementation leading to positive outcome, Pareto optimal outcome. I also spoke about unsound policy, which is the power tree for agriculture. Unsound policy, weak implementation, leading to suboptimal outcome. Now, how about I putting to you a puzzle, which is, supposing the policy were regressive, but supposing the implementation were sound, what would you describe the outcome?